To patch up and to repair those situations, Lord. we look at our own land and we see what's happened with we see a family destroyed by a crossbow attack. We see body parts found in suitcases. And we can see the wickedness that's in man's heart. And last night, as we watched the news on the television, maybe this morning, or heard the news, we see that there's an assassination attack on Donald Trump, which is narrowly survived, Lord. We think of the family of those who've lost their lives in that attack as well. And Lord, we just see that everywhere, that this world is in desperate need of the Lord Jesus. And so, Lord, we pray that you might come soon, that you might bring your peace and your kingdom upon this earth. Lord, we pray for the new government in this country. We pray for wisdom for them. And they'll need it as they rule over this land. Lord, we ask that you would bless them with that wisdom. Lord, that you would guide them in the decisions that they make. And may they make godly decisions, not those that just come by their heart. But, you know, may those who have a voice or a thought, a heart after you, may their voice be heard in Parliament, we pray. And Lord, we pray for ourselves as well. You know the struggles that come upon us as we live our lives day by day here. It's not always easy for us, Lord. And we just ask this, as we go through life, we might know you alongside to help and to encourage us. Sometimes, Lord, we wake up not feeling too good. Sometimes things go against us, and sometimes our health is not all it could be as well. And we do feel a bit downcast. But we thank you for your word and your promise that you will never leave us or forsake us, Lord. You will never lose any who come to you. And so, Lord, we thank you for the real encouragement that we get from that. And I pray too, Lord, as we look at your word a little later, that we'll be encouraged by what we read there when we go through this story of Samuel, 1 or 2 Samuel, for a long time now. We'll see the ups and downs in the life of David as well. I pray we can learn from that. And also, Lord, as we gather around the communion table, I pray that will be a time of blessedness to each one of us as well. So we ask you to hear our prayers, Lord. We just pray for Mike over our children as he leads the service there this morning. Be with him and Sinead in the church, so we pray that he'll have a blessed time as well. So we bring these prayers to you, Father, in the precious name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Let's have another hymn, shall we, please, Nick? The Ancient of Days.
None above him, all our time is his hand.
As we prepare to eat this bread, we cast our mind back to the upper room. We see you there with your disciples. We know know that Judas was there, and he betrayed you and left. You went ahead, Lord, and you spoke to your disciples and you encouraged them before you were going to leave them, Lord. You told them what was going to happen to you. They knew. And they had an idea what was going to happen. Well, I don't suppose anybody can envisage quite what you were going to go through. But Lord, as we look back, we know that you went to the cross and your body was broken for us. You suffered at the hands of men who unjustly treated you, unfairly treated you. They ridiculed you. Lord, they despised you. They spat upon you. They abused you. But Lord, that was part of the Father's plan, that you would pay for our sin, that we, the guilty ones, might go free. And so as we share this bread together, Lord, as we partake in this, Lord, I just pray you remind us in our hearts and our spirits of what it costs for us to be purchased by you, that you suffered greatly on our behalf, Lord. And we can only thank you and give you all the glory for what you've done for each one of us. So as we share this bread, Lord, may we do so humbly, with grateful hearts. Amen. So as Craig and Sam bring the bread around us, just eat if you receive, will you? You read through Hebrews, we read about all the offerings that were made in the Old Testament, all the animals that were slain. There was many, many thousands of animals that were sacrificed to the Lord as an atonement for sin. Not one of those things was actually blanked out by the death of those animals. They were masked over, it was a bit like wallpapering over the cracks. But it was all looking forward to the time when the Lord Jesus Christ would die on the cross and his perfect, precious blood would cancel out the death of our sins. And so as we share this morning, you know, we need to realise just how precious that blood was in the sight of God. His own Son hanging and dying upon the cross for us. Let's just have a prayer, shall we? Father, we can't always clearly understand just how this all works, Lord. We know that the blood of the Lord Jesus cancels out our sin, and we're so pleased that it does. We read through the Old Testament, we see all those animal sacrifices and many, many thousands that were sacrificed at different times. And yet, Lord, all pointed forward to that moment when the Lord Jesus Christ would be nailed on the cross and his blood would be shed for us. And we thank you that we know and we have that assurance that his blood cleanses us from all sin and we're willing and prepared to confess our sins before you. And so, Lord, I pray that each one of us is in that state where we are repentant. We ask for forgiveness of sins, Lord, and we know that we do that. Then we stand spotless before you in the Lord Jesus' righteousness. So as we share this cup, Lord, may we do so with joyful hearts. And as I always say, Lord, just give him the glory, we pray. Amen. Amen. Yeah. Brazil Hymn says there's power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Servant,
then you may defeat the counsel of Ahithophel from there. And do not have Zadok and Abiathar the priest with you there. Therefore it will be that whatever you hear from the king's house, you shall tell to Zadok and Abiathar the priest. Indeed, they have there with them their two sons, Ahimaaz and Zadok's son, Jonathan, Abiathar's son. And by them you shall send me everything you hear. So Hushai, David's friend, went into the city, and Absalom came into Jerusalem. So you can see that the uprising has taken place, and David is fleeing. And we're going to pick up in chapter 16. That's a sad picture that we have of David leaving his capital city and leaving his friends with the nation turned against him. But we'll go through that in a moment. I don't know how far we'll get to chapter 16. If I go through it all, we'll probably miss the football tonight. So I'll get stopped before then, I'm sure. Okay, let's sing in our faith, shall we? Deeply distressed by the situation, obviously. They're having to leave their homes. not knowing where they're going to go. We've sort of been following this life of David for some time now. We know just how things have been. I don't know if you remember, but a few weeks ago, I think it was, that, well, you must now, I'm not really sure. We looked at the passage in chapter 7 of 2 Samuel, and David was settled in his home. You see, we read there, he was seeking his home built of cedar wood. The Lord had given him rest from all his enemies, and everything was going around about. He says, here I am, I'm living in a palace or a big house of cedar. Everything was just fine. And he was established, he was at peace. You know, as I say, God built this fine house he built for himself. Life was good, just a little time earlier. And it was because life was good that David let his standards down. Remember what happened there? When we get to chapter 11, David sends his army out to war at springtime, but he doesn't feel there's a need for him to go, because everything's going so well, and he stays at home. And he wanders around on his rooftop, doesn't he? And he spots this woman bathing. And it's Bathsheba. And as we say, the rest of that's history. We've gone through all that, how he calls her, he summons her to his room. And it's this affair with Bathsheba that's causing David so much grief at the moment. If you remember, David the prophet was sent to David to confront him about all his behaviour with this woman. And he warns him, 2 Samuel chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. He says, Nathan says, the sword shall never depart from your house. You'll never have peace, right? And this is what the Lord says. He says, out of your own household, I'm going to bring calamity upon you. Before your very eyes, I will take your wives and give them to one who is close to you, and he will lie with your wives in broad daylight. And so we reach chapter 16 here. David's life is a mess. It's a disaster. And it's all a consequence of this affair that he had with Bathsheba. And the reason for David leaving Jerusalem is found in the verses of chapter 15, verses 13 and 14. David's son Absalom is leading a revolt. He wants to take over the throne. We looked a week or so back about how, at the beginning of chapter 15, where Absalom was riding around in a chariot of horses, he was getting himself noticed, and he won the hearts of the people of Israel, and now he's leading this revolt. And so, rather than seeing the civil war destroy Jerusalem, David's heading out into the wilderness to stop the battle taking place there. As he starts out on this journey, he comes into contact with two men. The two characters one of them we're familiar with. As we go through the story, we've got to remember that despite all his bad behaviour, what David has done wrong, right? He's still the anointed king of Israel. He's God's chosen king. That time has not come to an end, right? But Israel has been caught up in a great deception by Absalom. They believe that David is king. His time of ruling over his king has come to an end. It's time for Absalom to pick up the crown and become the new king of Israel. In chapter 15, verse 23, you can see the pain that this is causing. You look at verse 23, it says, and all the country wept with a loud voice, and all the people crossed over, the king himself crossed over to over the brook Kidron, and all the people crossed over towards the way of the wilderness. And you can see the pain of this situation. David is in bitterness as he leaves Jerusalem, his capital city. His heart is torn. He crosses the Kidron Valley. He walks across the Kidron Valley, which is what Jesus will do many years later. He'll cross that same valley. And David knows that the reason that all this has taken place is, is because of his son. Well, it's because of his son, because of what he committed with Bathsheba. And it's all down to his own behaviour. He's weeping, we read in verse 30, I think it is. He's weeping, he's got his head covered, he's going barefoot. I think it's verse 30, isn't it? Yeah, he's heartbroken, isn't he? And he's going up the Mount of Olives, he's ascending this mountain. And so as we look at verse 1, chapter 16, we read that David travels a short distance, right? He goes beyond the summit of the Mount of Olives, and he meets one of these two characters. Both of these two men that he meets, they add to the troubles of David. They put them with their own ideas, their own agenda, and they have little respect for David. So chapter 16, verse 1, says there, and when David was a little past the top of the mountain, there was Ziba, the servant of Mephibosheth, who met him with a couple of saddled donkeys, and on them 200 loaves of bread, 100 clusters of raisins, 100 summer fruits, and a skin of wine. And it seems to David that this is a little bit of an unusual situation. He can't get his head around it. So he asks, "What? Why have you brought all this stuff here?" He says to Sylvia, he knows it, but in this position, what are you doing here? Why have you come here? And look at Sylvia's answer in verse 2. He says, and the king said to Sylvia, what do you mean to do with these? So Sylvia said, the donkeys are for the king's household to ride on, the bread and the summer fruit for the young men to eat, and the wine for those who are faint in the wilderness. Right? We've come across this Ziba before. I don't know if you remember the story. Do you know where we found Ziba? It was in the story of Mephibosheth. I don't know if you remember, back in chapter 9. So it was that must have been a few weeks or months ago as well. David was wondering if there was anyone left in the house of Saul that he could show a kindness to. Anyone saying Saul's family. Because he had this covenant with Jonathan, Saul's son. And Ziba is called before him, who was a servant of Saul, and says, is there anyone who David could show kindness to? And he said, well, there's this man, Mephibosheth, who was one of Jonathan's sons, who was dropped by his nurse as they fled from the Philistines when Saul and his sons were killed in battle on Mount Gilboa. He's still surviving, right? He's still alive. He's living in the land of Lodabar. And David calls for Mephibosheth to come into his presence. Mephibosheth comes in terrified, but David tells him, look, you're always going to dominate my table, you're always going to be like one of my family today. And he commands Ziba and his sons and his servants to look after the fields. He restores to Mephibosheth the fields of his grandfather Saul, and he says that Ziba will look after and maintain for them. He'll bring in the crop, he'll bring in finances for you every year, you'll be looked after, but as for you, you're going to dine at my table. And so not only is Mephibosheth looked after, but Ziba is given employment and he's got a respectable job before King David. And so when David meets Ziba standing here, he's puzzled by these gifts. In the NIV, he says, why have you brought these? And the New King James says, what do you mean to do with these? What's the point of all this? You see, Ziba seems to be going that extra mile. He's doing that little something, that little bit extra special. He's preparing provisions for David. He's gone out of his way to do that. And he's got provisions for his men to sustain him on his journey through the wilderness. And it's wonderful. It's caring, isn't it? It's thoughtful. He's gone out of his way to do it. You know, Ziba goes up in David's estimation. He's even better than he thought. And so David turns around and he sort of says, well, where's Mephibosheth? Why isn't he here? Where is he? After all, David has shown exceptional sort of care to Mephibosheth. He's looked after him, he's treated him very well. It was normal in that day for a king to put to death anyone of the previous king's family to eliminate any sort of challenge to the throne. David was different because when he discovered one of Saul's descendants was alive, he made him as one of his own family. And as I said, he had a perpetual dining at his own table. But where is Mephibosheth? What's he up to? Where is he? What's he doing? Why is he here? David says, I can't quite understand what's going on. Where's Mephibosheth? So at this point, Ziba's been okay. He's done all the right things. But then his true self is revealed, okay? He tells a whopping great lie. He tells David this huge lie. When David is at this real low point, as he's leaving Jerusalem, right? Ziba turns up looking like a really good friend, someone who's providing for him, right? But he's deceiving David with a huge lie. Ziba appears, as I say, to be caring and have good intentions toward David. That's what it looks like. But actually, Ziba is only thinking of himself. He's only caring about himself. And as I say, bear in mind that all through this story, David is God's anointed king, and he's faced now with a lying person who's a deceiver. Just look at Ziba's reply in verse 3. Then the king said, where is your master's son? Where's Mephibosheth? And Ziba said to the king, indeed, he's staying in Jerusalem. For he said, today the house of Israel will restore the kingdom of my father to me. This is a huge lie. This is a massive lie. I know, because I've read to the end of the story. It doesn't seem like it, but if you read through the whole story, it is. And it's aimed at shaming his master. It's aimed at shaming Mephibosheth, and at the same time it puts Ziba in a good light before David. So at this point of the story, Mephibosheth is slandered with this news line, which David swallows hook, line, and sinker. He takes the whole thing on board. Now Jesus warned us about being deceived and being taken in by what we see with our own eyes. He says in John 7:24, do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. And David just judges by what he sees, really. Proverbs 18:16 says this, because it's easy to be tricked by what we see. Proverbs 18:16 says this, a man's gifts makes room for him and brings him before great men. You know, gifts and bribes, they buy people into places or into the good books of people who they've got no right to be. You know, and this is what he has done. He brought this gift. Proverbs 18:17, which follows that, says, the first one to plead his cause seems to be right, until his neighbour comes and examines him. The first one to state their case, the first one to say what's going on, they tell their side of things, it seems to be plausible, and that becomes the accepted story, that becomes the truth. And it becomes quite difficult to disprove that. And so Mephibosheth tells this story, it seems plausible to David, and David accepts it as the truth. And so we've got here, we've got Ziba the Fibber, I call him, okay? He's brought David donkeys, he's got the donkeys for David to ride on, he's got food to sustain him, he's got wine to refresh him. And he's saying, Mephibosheth, who you treated so well, you looked after so well, you had a dog on your table, well, he's turned into a real rat. He's let you down, he's turned on you, and he's waiting to take over the kingdom. And it just adds to the despair of David. But David believes it all. He believes that Mephibosheth has turned on the let down. And with that, David makes a hasty decision. He probably doesn't think it through too carefully. He acts on the spur of the moment. He's in a terrible position, you know. His family and friends and the nation, they've all turned against him. And so he's not thinking that clearly. But look at verse 4. So the king said to Ziba, here, all that belongs to Mephibosheth is yours. And Ziba said, I can't be back before you, that I might find favour in your sight, O my Lord. Ziba gains everything because of a lie, right? And Mephibosheth loses everything because of a lie. And it all takes place behind Mephibosheth. He's a crippled man, it all takes behind his back. He doesn't know anything about it. He's got no chance to defend himself. Everything goes to pieces. In the heat of the moment, David is trapped by a liar and a deceiver. Common sense says, let Mephibosheth have a say. Let him put his point over. You know, they have some input into the situation, but it's too late. David was acting on the spur of the moment. He's just made up his mind and he's gone ahead and made his judgment. And so David completely misjudges someone who was loyal to him because he believed the scandal and the liar. Now ask yourself, do you think it's possible that you might jump to conclusions like that? Do you think it's possible for you to do that? Now, before you've weighed up fairly, before you make your mind up, do you think you can ever jump to conclusions about people like that? Have you ever weighed up someone like that, you know, before you've got all the facts? David should have waited until he heard both sides of the argument. Do you think it's possible that you could have misjudged someone who is loyal to you in the past, caused a great rift between you, fall into the same trap as David? It's so easy when we hear something, when we make rash decisions to do the wrong thing. The Lord Jesus was nailed on a cross, wasn't he? Because of false witnesses. People said the wrong thing about him. They all came and said one thing after another. They were all prepared for what to say. They accused him of many things, but at no time did anyone say, let's have a look at the other side of the argument. Let's really delve into this and see the truth of it. No one came to test whether it was true or not. Jesus was nailed on the cross because of false accusations. So in verse 5 it says, now when King David had come to Baharim, there was a man from the family of the house of Zor, whose name was Shimei, the son of Gera, coming from there. He came out, cursing continuously as he came. So as David leaves Ziba behind, he carries on his journey. He's going north of Jerusalem, he travels through the land of the tribe of Benjamin. He has to go through Benjamin on his journey to the wilderness. And many, many months ago, when we were back in 1 Samuel 9, we read a verse one of that chapter. It says there was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish. Right? Do you remember Kish? And in verse 2, we read that he was the father of who? Saul. He was Saul's father. Okay? Saul was a Benjamite. And so David was passing through a land of Saul supporters. Okay? They were hostile to him. You know, this is worse than a Norwich fan walked through Ipswich in his green and yellow. It's much worse than that. I saw in the news this week, I don't know whether you saw it, that there's been a call for a public inquiry into what happened during the miners' strike in 1984. I don't know whether you saw that. After all this time, since 1984, tensions are still running strong below the surface in those mining villages. But what happened all those years ago, you know, they're still deeply affected by what happened. And in the Benjamite's eyes, you know, as David comes through, all those old tensions are reopened. They believe that David took over the position that rightly belonged to Benjamin, to the house of Saul. And now that Absalom has sort of initiated this uprising, you know, and David's on the run, there's a small group who are still loyal to Saul, or a big group, should I say, and all the old wounds are opened up. And they despise and they hate David. Here we've got this man, Shimei. And it's quite clear that he totally resents David. He comes along, he's swearing continuously that David is a man with a foul mouth. He can't stop swearing. There are occasions in life when you have the misfortune to come across people who, for some reason or other, want to scatter swear words in their sentences, maybe every other one or two words. They think it's acceptable to talk like that. You know, just swearing every other word they speak. I once worked with a bloke like that. He had foul language, and in the end, he just got to the stage where he didn't want to talk to him. It was unpleasant. And when you meet a man with a foul mouth, you know, full of bad language, and someone's got a heart full of hatred, you've got a picture of this Shimei here, and you can see what his behaviour must have been like. For him, David was everything bad. You know, he was everything that could be wrong in the world. That was how he saw David. He doesn't see him as God's anointed king. He's just the atmosphere. In verse 6 it says, he threw stones at David and at all the servants of King David, and all the people and all the mighty men were on his right hand and on his left hand. That means that the mighty men of David were around him. He's picking up stones and he's throwing stones at David and the mighty men who were there with David. And being hit with a stone is painful. And I've said, how do you, but it's painful business. As David makes his way, you know, he's walking this sorrowful path into exile, you know, into wilderness, he's in distress, right? First he meets a man bearing gifts who tells him, what a great life, and then he has a man who comes to him cursing him and throwing stones at him, you know, making false accusations against him. Look in verse 7. Now, in the NIV, if you look in verse 7, it says, as he cursed, Shimei said, get out, you man of blood, you scoundrel. Get out of the country, get out. You know, we don't want you here. And I imagine that he does this for a sort of an advantageous position. I don't think he's just walking along the side of the road next to David and throwing stones. So in my mind's eye, I believe that David must have been walking in a valley or a ravine, and Shimei's up there somewhere, a little bit sort of somewhere safe. He can afford to throw stones down upon David and the men and think that he's got a little bit of a barrier between him and them coming after him. And it's from this position that he hurls these insults and accuses David and throws stones, as we read in verse 10. In verse 13 it says, look, as David's men went along the road, Shimei went along the hillside opposite him, and cursed as he went and threw stones at him and kicked up dust. So he is above David, he's kicking this dirt and this dust that's come down on David and his men and all the company. And all the time he's telling David just what a worthless fellow he is, just what a piece of rubbish he is. In the middle of all these difficulties that David was going through, right? You know, this is just something terrible David doesn't need. It's just heaping trouble on David's head. You know, in the middle of all these circumstances, he's having to contend with this man. And this is a picture of a situation that the Bible warns each of us against, or about, should I say. In the middle of difficulties, when circumstances can get on top of us because of whatever reason, whatever it might be, Satan's there to deceive you and I. He's there to lie to us, and he's there to accuse us, and he tries to make the path that we're travelling so much more difficult. they say, accuses and tells us what worthless people we are. We're no good, just as she was saying to David. His aim is to make you just want to give up. He just wants you to just put your hands here and say, that's enough, I'm finished. And this is really what Shimmy's doing to David. He's just putting more and more problems onto David. If you want a good example of how this has worked, this is meant to work, you read the book of Job. How his friends turned against him and told him how he must have done something to offend God, that he was not right. You know, it's Satan's job to try and destroy us and to bring us down. And it's the job of the Lord Jesus. He raises us up and brings us back to God. You know, when you're being told what a worthless being you are, and you'll hear that, you'll get it in your heart sometimes. Remember who it is who uses words like this. You know who it is. It's the enemy, isn't it? It's the devil. He wants to put you down. He wants to destroy your witness. He wants to destroy your faith. So in verse 8, it says, Shimmy speaking, right? He says, the Lord has brought upon you all the blood of the house of Saul, in whose place you have reigned. The Lord has delivered the kingdom into the hand of Absalom your son, so now you are caught in your own evil, because you are a bloodthirsty man. So Shimmy is making a false accusation against David, and we've seen that David never ever mistreated anyone of the house of Saul at all. He always went out his way to be good to the house of Saul. We've seen that in the past. You know, even when Saul was hunting down, David would not lift his hand against Saul. And not only that, Shimmy also talks like God has revealed this to him. You know, this is a special word view from God. The Lord says this. He talks as though he's got this special contact with God. Like he knows the will of God. He's got no understanding of the situation whatsoever. It's because his heart is so full of hate. And he's just saying whatever comes into his head straight away. Look at verse 6, it says there, and he threw stones at David, all the servants of King David, and all the people, and all the mighty men were on his right hand and on his side. So as I said, David's walking along, he's got his mighty men, his soldiers, his bodyguard, all around him, right? And as David's making his way along, he's protected by these mighty men. And these are his best fighting men, his real warriors, right? And as Shimei sort of heard these insults and chucking the stones and kicking the dirt, these men are suffering. These mighty warriors are suffering. So when we get to verse 9, look, Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, said to the king, why should this dead dog curse at my lord the king? Please let me go over and take off his head. I don't know if you remember Abishai. He's the son of David's sister Zeruiah. We read about him a long time ago again, back in 1 Samuel chapter 26. When David takes a man to creep into the camp of Saul at night, they get it out and find Saul asleep, and the man with it, who was Abishai, says, let me put a spear through him, let me kill him as he sleeps. And David says, don't touch him, he's God's chosen king. He says, well, take his spear and his water jug. Do you remember the story? You might have heard that. That's Abishai. Abishai is quite happy to kill people. He hasn't got a problem again. And here he seems, you know, a bit of a hothead. He's quite happy to go and do another little bit of killing, you know. And he says to David, look, no one should speak to you like that. Just let me go over and have a deal with this bloke. Shut him up once and for all. And if David had just given them the nod of the head, said, okay, then Shimei would be no more. But David doesn't do that. He doesn't do that. You know, if you was David or I was David, how would we have dealt with that situation? When someone has given us so much trouble, what would we say? Well, go on then, go and do it. But David wouldn't do it. In verse 10, David says, leave him alone. Let him curse me because the Lord has told him to do so. God's told him to do it. And that sounds a bit strange, doesn't it? The Lord has told him to do it. Just think about that for a moment. The Lord's told him to do it. When someone brings disruption or pain into your life, you need to look to see if God is telling you something. Is God trying to speak to you? Has God got something to say to you? David could see the hand of God in what was happening to him. He was being forced out. He was going into the wilderness. He was journeying. He was having trials as he went. And he knew because of what Nathan told him, it was because of what happened when he had that affair with Bathsheba. David knew that these accusations of David were untrue. He knew he was not guilty of the blood of anybody in the house of Saul. He knew that for a fact. He was, however, guilty of the blood of Uriah the Hittite, Bathsheba's husband. He couldn't get away from that. You know, if he looked at his life, there was plenty of things that were wrong in his life. There was plenty of reasons why David should be cursed, why David should be cast out. There was more than enough to condemn David. But God was speaking into David's heart and making him look at himself and consider his position. And he was using this fallen earth man to do it. That seems sort of quite strange, doesn't it? He also used, as I say, Ziba the Fibba. We'll see more of that later on. And he's using his rebellious son Absalom. They're all being used by God to help David to see his situation, to bring him to repentance. When things are not going well for you, then you may well feel that the devil has put you through the wringer. Everything's going wrong. But more important than your awful situation is, what is God saying to me? What is God telling me in the middle of all of this? Now, on Wednesday evenings, we're going through the story of Jonah. And Jonah went through the wringer. He went through a storm and was swallowed by a great fish because God was talking to him and bringing him back to the place where he wanted him to be. How do you think Joseph felt when his brother sold him as a slave? And he was bought by Potiphar, and Potiphar's wife falsely accuses him, and he ends up in prison. How do you think he felt by that? When he stands before his brothers at the end of all his suffering, he says to his brothers, actually, it was not you who sent me here, it was God. God brought me all through all of this, but there was a purpose in it. It was to save you. What about Paul? You know, it's another one. Paul writes in, look, I'll just read that, in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul says this, he says, from the Jews, 5 times I received 40 stripes minus 1. 3 times I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked, night and day I've been in the deep. In journeys often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils of the city, in perils of the wilderness, in perils at sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and toil, in sleeplessness often, in hunger and thirst, in thirsting and fastings often, in cold and nakedness. And he goes on to say, look, he says, unless I should be exalted above all men because of what he suffered, right? And he could talk about it. He says, a thorn in the flesh was given to me. It was a messenger of Satan who brought it to me. A messenger of Satan given to Paul, that great man. What was the Lord teaching? He said, but the Lord was teaching. He said, I asked the Lord to take away from me, but the Lord was teaching me this one, he says. The Lord was teaching me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. In all of these things, Paul was learning. Paul had to learn. You know, we need to see in the middle of our suffering what God was teaching us, right? We need to look to God, even in the middle of something that's really painful and causes distress. Another reason that David didn't want to kill Shimon was because he wasn't the real cause of David's problems. He wasn't the real reason, was he? He was just adding to it. David's real problem was the fact that, well, look in verse 11, and David said to Abishai and all his servants, see how my son, who came from my own body, seeks my life. He's the real problem. My real problem is Absalom, my own son. This is the one that I need to deal with. See how he seeks my life. If Shimon's killed, if you put it to death, my problem still remains. David is dealing with a civil uprising. That's his real problem. His own son is leading it. In the middle of all this aggravation, David keeps his focus on what's the real problem. He's not distracted from that. In the middle of any crisis, your distress, fix your mind on the problem, on the real problem. Deal with the problem. Deal with that. When you deal with the problem, then all the little things, the issues that surround it, they'll be dealt with at the same time. You deal with that problem by turning it over to the Lord. It's the only way to do it. Go to God straight away. He's the real answer to our problems. He's the one who will eventually deal with it and sort it out. Now just to finish, look at what David's real hope is. Look at verse 12. It says, it may be, he said, David says, it may be that the Lord will look upon my affliction and the Lord will repay me with good for his curse in this day. Never stop looking for the Lord's blessing. In the middle of your problems, in the middle of your distress, always look for God's blessing. David never gave up on God. He never gave up on God's blessing. Throughout all of his ups and downs in life, David always had complete trust in God. It never failed. He let God down, but God never let know that eventually, well, I know, because I read the story, you might know, that eventually the kingdom is restored to David. He comes back in triumph, right? The longer, well, I'm going to quickly read through it, but just to give you a little bit of background, and we'll finish with this, right? So I have time to go on, you want to see the text. Chapter 19, verse 15, you can follow it quickly if you want to. Chapter 19, verse 15, yeah. It says, then the king returned, right? The king returned, David comes back. The king returned and came to Jordan and Judah, and came to Gilgal, and go to and Judah and Gilgal go to lead the king, to escort the king across the Jordan. Look at verse 16. And Shimei, the son of Gera, a Benjamite, who was from Baharim, hurried and came down with the men of Judah to meet King David. There were 1,000 men of Benjamin with him. And Zimmah, the servant of the house of Saul, his 15 sons, and his 20 servants with him, and they went over the Jordan before the king. Then the ferry boat went across to carry over the king's household and to do what he thought good. Now Shimei, the son of Gera, fell down before the king when he had crossed the Jordan. See, there's been a repentance, a bit of change of heart. And they're the first people to go out and welcome the king when he comes back to reclaim his kingdom. You see, there's been God's work in their hearts. There's been a huge change. These two men, both of them, they come back, they greet David, they both have this change. They've been an act of repentance. They've realized that they've done the wrong thing. Some people say, well, the king is coming back and they know that they want to get on the right side of him. Yeah, they do. Who wouldn't? Who wouldn't? You know, don't underestimate what God can do to those people who cause you trouble. Don't underestimate what God can do in the hearts of your enemies. God can change things around completely. And he turns these men around, these people who sin. They turn around and they repent because they're in fear of their lives. Do you know that one day the King of Kings is going to return? He's going to come back, isn't he? That's what Scripture teaches us, that God's anointed King is going to return. He's going to come back to this world. He's going to judge all those who've lied about him, falsely accused him, said all kinds of slanderous things about him. Those who deny him, he's going to judge them all. He will sit on his throne of judgment against all those people who stood against him. Shimei came and fell down before the king. He fell down at his feet. He worshipped him. He begged for forgiveness because he knew the authority of David, what David could do for him. If you read through that chapter 19, David says in verse 23, you shall not die, you shall live. You shall live. If you've not already done so, you need to learn from Zimmah and Shimei. Read this story through. They beg for mercy from the king and they receive it. What do we read at the start of the service? The one of you comes to me, the Lord Jesus says, I will by no means cast out. His door, his hands, his arms are always open for those who come. And the Lord always remains true to his word. We haven't got time to go so much, but we need to stop here. But if you haven't come to the Lord Jesus, time's getting short. We know that by what's going on in the world. We need to come back to him. We need to come back to him with repentant hearts and say sorry for the way we've abused him, mistreated him, neglected him. We need to get right with the Lord our Savior, don't we? The King of Kings, before he comes back to this world to judge him. Let's sing our closing hymn. And can be that I should go.
Thank you. sing hymns like that with gusto and really mean it to the Lord. So thank you for that, Lord. We thank what we looked at too this morning. We see the heart of you is to forgive and to receive us back as well. So be with us now, Lord, as we share a time of fellowship, a cup of tea, coffee, and a biscuit. And as we go to our house, watch over as we pray for the rest of the week, we ask you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.